about to give before the committee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help you God. Thank you. Proceed with your statement.
Good morning and thank you, Chairman Grassley, Ranking Member Feinstein, and members of the committee. It's a privilege to appear before you today. U.S. Customs and Border Protection's counterterrorism, border security, trade enforcement, agriculture protection, and trade and travel facilitation missions are essential to U.S. homeland and economic security. With over 60,000 professionals working to protect the American people every day, it is my honor to serve alongside them as commissioner. Over the past year, we've made strides across almost every area of our mission. We have facilitated record levels of trade and travel, interdicted increasing quantities of hard narcotics, enhanced screening and vetting, implemented the Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act, and continued our commitment to ensure our officers and agents are safe as they carry out their critical duties and have the best training, policy, and equipment. The list goes on, and I'm very fortunate to have a tremendous leadership team and a dedicated and innovative workforce at CBP to make progress across all these key areas. Within CBP's broad responsibility, I recognize that our border security mission and our immigration enforcement efforts are of the greatest interest to this committee. Here, we have made great strides as well. CBP's ability to detect and interdict illegal border crossings has never been higher. We are putting initial investments in border wall system to good use and have already built critical sections of modern wall in key border areas where it has made an immediate impact. We have turned around our hiring and ended the last fiscal year with almost 500 more frontline officers and agents. We maintain the most capable civilian law enforcement air and marine operations in the world and are accelerating the development and deployment of cutting-edge technology to our workforce. And we've extended our shared zone of security through enhanced international partnerships and capacity building throughout the hemisphere and beyond. That is not to say we do not face challenges in our border security mission. Clearly, the increased smuggling of heroin, fentanyl, and other synthetic opioids, along with growing rates of methamphetamine that are devastating communities across the United States, remains a critical focus. And at the border, we face changing trends in illegal crossings that impact security, exploit our laws, and challenge our resources and personnel. To put this aspect of our mission in context, one day of crossings, last Monday, December 3rd, highlights the trends that we are confronting. On that day, we saw the highest numbers of arrivals at our southwest border in years, 3,029 illegal entries and inadmissible persons arrived at our border last Monday. 85% of them crossed illegally. CBP apprehended or encountered 1,731 members of family groups and 350 unaccompanied children. This means that the illegal crossings and inadmissibles last Monday included over 1,100 children in a single day. This snapshot is emblematic of the steady trends that we've been seeing for many months, increasing crossings overall with a dramatic surge in the percentage of family units and a growing proportion of Central Americans coming to our border. More broadly, for the last 30 days, we've seen over 2,000 unlawful entries between ports and undocumented arrivals at ports of entry each day. Over 1,070 family members are arriving on a consistent basis. To put this in perspective, we will more than double last year's record number of family units at this rate. I've heard a number of commentators observe that even at these levels, the numbers we are seeing are lower than historical peaks, and as a result, they suggest what we are seeing at the border today is not a crisis. I fundamentally disagree with this assessment. From the experience of our agents and officers on the ground, it is indeed both a border security and a humanitarian crisis. What many looking at the total numbers fail to understand is the difference in what is happening now in terms of who is crossing, the risks that they are facing in the journey, and the consequences for our system. First, up until this decade, most of those crossing the border illegally were single adult males. Now the majority crossing are family units and unaccompanied children. This was fewer than 10% up until the year 2012. 59% of crossings last month were families and unaccompanied children. Second, migration from Mexico remains at historically low levels. While the majority of illegal border crossings now come from three countries of Central America, Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador. Central America has now exceeded Mexican migration 4 out of the last 5 years and reached 70% of crossings last month. November was the first month in recorded history where more people arrived from another country than Mexico, with Guatemala exceeding Mexico by 3,000. The third major trend is a dramatic increase in claims of fear of return, or asylum claims. Between 2000 and 2013, fewer than 1% of those encountered at our border claimed asylum. Last year at ports of entry, the number of asylum claims more than doubled to 38,269. Nearly 31% of those deemed inadmissible at ports of entry claimed asylum. These increases in demographic changes and crossings are direct responses to the vulnerabilities in our legal framework that have become well known to smugglers and migrants. These weaknesses in our laws now represent the most significant factors impacting border security, and they include the asylum gap, where approximately 80% of individuals meet the initial credible fear bar in the asylum process, while only 10 to 20% are found to have valid asylum claims at the end of their immigration court proceedings. The disparate treatment under the Trafficking Victims Protection and Reauthorization Act, still a critical statute, but it allows for children arriving from Mexico and Canada to be repatriated, but not from other countries, including those in Central America. And the inability to keep families together while they complete expeditious and fair immigration proceedings. Instead, crossing with a child is a near guarantee of a speedy release. These deficiencies ensure a high likelihood of success, and the trends they invite have significant ramifications. First, our infrastructure is incompatible with this reality. Our Border Patrol stations and ports of entry were built to handle mostly male single adults in custody, not families or children. Second, the illegal crossings have a much different character, with families and children coming across in large groups and simply presenting themselves to Border Patrol agents. The smugglers are choosing the timing and location for these crossings strategically in order to disrupt our border security efforts, create a diversion for smuggling of narcotics, and allow single adults seeking to evade capture to sneak in. Even worse, these smugglers visit horrible violence, sexual assault, and extortion on some of the most vulnerable people in our hemisphere. And lastly, these trends mean that regardless of whether an individual who has entered illegally has a valid case for protection or asylum, they are increasingly unlikely to be repatriated. Indeed, only 1.5% of family units from Central America apprehended over a full fiscal year ago in 17 have been removed to their countries of origin, despite the fact that most will not end up having valid claims to remain in the U.S. when their court proceedings conclude. That perception that our system will allow them to stay in the U.S. indefinitely is clearly the driving pull factor for those making the journey to our border. Along with important push factors, which include challenging conditions in many parts of Central America, this incentivizes them to put their lives in the hands of smugglers and make the dangerous trek north to the southwest border. The cost of these pull and push factors is seen every day in profits derived by TCOs and lives lost on the journey and in the loss of youth and energy from the countries of the Northern Triangle. This is clearly both a border security and a humanitarian crisis. There are solutions to this crisis, and many of them have broad support. We need to continue to support the governments of Central America to improve economic opportunities, to address poverty and hunger, and to improve governance and security. We must work with the new administration in Mexico on addressing transnational criminal organizations that prey on migrants, and we must invest in border security, including a modern border wall system, additional technology at ports of entry, additional agents and officers, and air and marine support. All of these steps will make a difference. But we must also confront and address the vulnerabilities in our legal framework for lasting change at the border. As we engage in discussion of CBP's border security and immigration missions today, I urge the committee to consider the acute need for legislative action with this backdrop. Thank you for the opportunity to testify. I look forward to the committee's questions.
5 minutes.